sometimes things just come together naturally, and this meeting and this grouping of educators and manufacturers, the timing couldn't be more perfect for what we're trying to do with this initiative. So I know time's limited, so just let me jump in. So I saw the hands earlier, so manufacturers, I'm talking to you. Are you satisfied with the quality and quantity of the skilled workers applying for your job openings? I don't see anybody doing cartwheels, so I take it there are some issues with that. Okay. So the ADAM project that we're working on covers these four occupational groups. There are lots of different jobs and occupations within these, but these are the four big buckets that we are working in across the state. So what are we hearing from manufacturers in the ivory tower? We're hearing that you're struggling to fill your vacant positions, that you've got to replace a lot of different occupations. Jim spoke to this earlier. And you want better candidates that have better skills, so when they come in, they are ready to go, or very close to ready to go, so maybe a short OJT is all they need to meet your production needs. Okay. Well, we have other constituencies we deal with as well in workforce development. Those are the job seekers, the folks that have barriers to employment, those that are laid off. So what they're telling us, they need a good paying job now, especially if there are have a family or mid-career or older, have been out of school for a while. They don't have time to wait for the academic calendar to roll around to take 2 years of training to get back into the workforce. Their need is much more urgent than that. Okay. The problem they have is if they go into that kind of program, if they don't have money coming in, they've got to take some kind of odd job to have some sort of income. A lot of them do anyway. So that adds more pressure on top of not only are they trying to take a full-time educational program, but they're maybe working 1, 2, 3 part-time jobs just to stay afloat and pay the mortgage, keep the kids fed. Okay. That's not something I would wish on anybody. Okay. Is there anything that's worse than another government program, except maybe a multi-agency government program? All right, well, it's multi-agency for a region. All these agencies, in some way, have an impact on the workforce system, on the education training side, on trying to find the clients, trying to get people over, to overcome those barriers to employment, and working with employers to make that happen. Okay, there's a reason that the manufacturers are listed first. That's not just cosmetic. This is entirely a demand-driven attempt. We're trying to make sure that whatever we're doing is responsive to what you, the employers, are telling us that you need. And again, this is an entirely different approach to the way we've done things before. It literally is an experiment, and I'll talk about that at the end of this slide. But it's a program model that emphasizes the pull, the demand. Okay. For us to figure out what that is, we need manufacturers' involvement to help us figure that out. You know, we can't rely on LMI data, labor market information data, that is churned because that's always, you know, 6 months to a year behind the time. Okay, we need real-time data from you folks to tell us what are your needs right now, what do you think they're going to be in the immediate and near-term future. Okay, another element that we are emphasizing in this is integration of program services. We don't want to be referring our clients, and who are our clients in this? They're people that are Workforce Investment Act eligible either as an adult or a dislocated worker. So that's the kind of trainees that we're talking about under this model. Another key element is acceleration. What can we do to get those folks the training they need, the credentials they need that employers are telling us that have value to them, and as quickly as possible with as limited downtime as possible? Who here has done any kind of Lean or Six Sigma? Okay, great. Now, remember who raised your hand there. How many, raise your other hand. How many of you ever said government needs to try to run more like a business? Okay, well, there are a lot of reasons why some government always can't do that, but here's one case where we're gonna give it a try. We're gonna try to apply lean principles to this project, meaning there's no downtime, and we're not gonna do a single thing that's not value added. So if somebody's waiting for a training cohort to start, let's see if we can get them into some sort of job shadowing opportunity or a work experience opportunity. Something that adds value, helps them make a better career decision, and gives an employer a chance to see that individual. We were talking about internships earlier. A lot of opportunities for try before you buy in this model. Okay. Back to, we talked about it being an experiment. There will be a statistical evaluation done and evaluative effort done. When this is done, we're going to see if people came through this system faster and what were the outcomes for those folks were compared to folks that are in the regular workforce system. What does that mean for all of you? Let me get out of the bureaucratese talk. It's the opportunity to prove if this kind of model makes a difference. And if it does make a difference, how much of a difference? This is a national grant that came to Illinois. We applied for it competitively and were awarded this grant from a national competition. U.S. Department of Labor is watching this. And if this study shows that doing the things that we're doing have a positive impact, there will be policy changes made at the national level directly because of this effort. Not just what they need, but when they need it, and how much of it they need. What particular skill sets are important, not just occupations, but what are the skills? What exact things do you need us to do training on to meet your need? And the better intelligence we have coming back from that, the better we can design this, and we'll design this to address those specific issues. What it boils down to is we want to do training that is the right skills in the right skills at the right time and in the right quantity. If we have 100 slots to do occupation X, I'll pick something we probably don't do here at all, gonculator repair. Okay. If we have 100 slots for gonculator repair, but there are only 10 jobs out there, what do those extra 90 people do? Probably not go into a job here. They either have to move somewhere else or take out some other kind of training program to meet the demands of what the market is saying. So what we're trying to do here is provide training that is responsive to what the market is telling us the demand is. Okay. We talked about acceleration. One key thing about this, we want to have, to the fullest extent possible, open entry and open exit. Employers, back to you. How many of you, when you have a good opportunity coming in and a new order's coming in, you're going to hire folks, how many of you say, no, let's wait and do that until classes start in the fall? Anybody? Okay. On the other side of the curve, maybe you have to downsize a little bit to meet the market reality. How many of you all say, no, let's wait till fall when classes start? Anybody do that? I doubt it. Okay. So what we're trying to do here is figure out a way that our system can be more responsive and on demand, okay, so that we're not tied to the academic calendar, but we are tied to when you need the workers. So when layoffs happen, we have a glut of people that have good skills in manufacturing, maybe a little bit of training, they can go right back into the workforce in another manufacturer. Or maybe they are out, not in manufacturing at all, but they have to change careers entirely. We can get those folks trained for the entry-level and lower mid-level jobs, depending on how long they can stay in training. But the other key part of it is, for folks that have that kind of background, say on a scale of 0 to 10, 10 being perfect, they're at a 6, and you've got a 12-week training program. Why on earth would you make that person sit through the first 5 weeks of that training program if they know that already, right? So let's have them do some work experience, something that's added value, an internship, whatever it is, but not make them sit in class and go over stuff they already know how to do, okay? Then when they're ready to pick up, they come into class, they finish out, they get their credential, and they move on, okay? The idea is that that's back to lean, right? Sitting in class for 5 weeks if they already know that stuff is not value added. So they could be doing something different in front of an employer, getting an additional skill, or at least learning more about the workforce or the workplace that's out there to make themselves more value added and give them more opportunities for being hired later. We're all about stackable credentials. That's been mentioned a few times today. Everybody that goes through this program will start out with the MSSC Intro to Manufacturing and Safety. Everybody's going to get that credential. Okay. They have the option to take additional MSSC credentials, also NIMS, welding credentials, and APICs. Okay. Just depends on the individual. We've pretty much talked about this. But the idea is that we want to, as soon as folks demonstrate a competency, out the door. Okay. Okay, how can we reduce hiring risks? How can we take the uncertainty out? The age-old catch-22 is, you know, I need experience for a job, but I need the job for experience, right? So having the credentials is great, but how can you be sure they're really going to be a good worker? That's that soft skills issue that keeps coming up over and over again. Okay. Part of our lean processing here is if they're waiting for a cohort to start, or even if they're not, they'll also be getting soft skill training along with that. If they go out into a work experience and there's some things identified they need to work on, that can be identified to the case manager, and we can take a corrective action with that person. So when they finish real manufacturing training and go out, they're ready, and they're ready to come work for you. Okay. Under this program, the work experiences, the internships can be paid by the program. So at no cost to the employer other than your time and effort involved in helping supervise that. Folks that come into this program will already be drug screened. They have to pass a drug test to even get in the program. They also have to submit to a background check. Okay. And if they go into an OJT opportunity, we can reimburse from 50 to 90% of their wages while they're in training, okay, depending on the size of the employer. The smaller the employer, the more we can reimburse. Okay. And if you use placement agencies exclusively for your hires, we've figured out a way to help you make that work as well. So that's not that's not something we can't overcome here. So back to Mr. Hahn's comment earlier. That really resonated with me because he didn't want to be that person that complained about something, but then not be willing to take part in trying to fix it. Okay. So let me ask you all here. Are you dissatisfied with quality and quantity of your workers enough to join us in trying to make things better? If you are at that point, and because you're here, that tells me you've passed that hurdle already. You care about this and you're ready to invest in this. What we need for you to do is talk to your peers and let them know about this program as well. But here's what, you know, if you are interested in this, here's what we're asking of employers to bring to the table. Tell us about your openings that you expect to have in the coming future. Okay. Tell us when you're going to have those, and then what competencies that are involved in that and where they're going to be at. And then also be willing to pony up and help us create those opportunities for work-based learning and OJTs and career exploration. Okay. And then when our graduates come out of the training, you give those folks at least a shot at an interview. Okay. I would think you'd be happy to interview those folks because they will have been trained to your specifications. And you may be lucky enough that they've already done a work experience or an internship with you already, so you know them already. So there's some value added for your investment in time as well. So where are we doing, Adam? Okay. It's not statewide, so there are five regions. The central region pretty much covers a lot of the group here. And then there are a few counties in the group here that are in the Metro East region down by East St. Louis and Madison County. However, if you are an employer in one of these great counties, there still may be a way for you to play. Okay. We just have to overcome the logistics of getting folks to you and how close you are to the training. Okay. If you want more information about it, you could talk to me or Jim. Also, if you go to this website that's listed up there, that's optimized for smartphones, so if you go to that on your phone, you can learn more about it. If you're interested in partnering this in any way, either from the private sector side, from the training provider side, or if you have clients that might be interested in it, see Larry afterward and he can tell you all about it. If you're not closer to that region, not in that region, you're more southwest region, let me or Jim know and we'll connect you up with those folks. But again, if this looks at all interesting, talk to your peers and let's see if we can generate something that could change national policy and make the whole system better for all of us. Appreciate your time. Thanks.